Welcome to my calculus class. Whether you're doing it in person or just online, welcome. But before we start learning calculus, let's take a minute to think about what is calculus. Here's my definition. Calculus is the study of things that change. And in the real world, that means just about everything. So, for example, back in algebra class, you might have done a problem like this. Car moves at constant speed, goes 180 miles in 3 hours. How fast is it going? 180 miles divided by 3 hours, 60 miles an hour. Okay. But that's assuming the car is going at constant speed. Unless you've got it on cruise control, it's not going to go at constant speed. You're going to speed up and slow down depending on road conditions, depending on traffic, depending on the driver's mood. So how do you deal with that? If you have a car moving with variable speed, how do you figure out its velocity at any given time from data? And what would the data be? Well, the data might be your position as a function of time. If somebody gives you the position at a function of time, how do you find the speed? Another problem might be the reverse. See, before we used distance and had to figure out speed, an algebra problem might say, you're going at 60 miles an hour from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock. You start at milepost 100. Where do you wind up? And you say, 3 hours times 60 miles an hour is 180 miles. Start at mile 100. You must wind up at milepost 280. Or maybe you're going the opposite direction. But let's suppose you're going the direction of milepost 280. In calculus, you say, if somebody gives you your velocity as a function of time, and you were at milepost 100 at 1 o'clock, where are you going to be at 4 o'clock? You have to somehow use information about the rate at which you're changing, that's your velocity, and use that to figure out your position. An even harder calculus problem is where somebody gives you not the velocity as a function of time, but the velocity is a function of position. This doesn't happen in, that may sound unrealistic, but there are plenty of situations in biology or economics where the rate of change of some quantity is directly related to what that quantity is. So in this case, velocity, the rate of change of position, is some function of position. And if you have an equation like that, we call it a rate equation. What can you say about the resulting trajectory? Those are the kinds of questions that we're going to try to answer in calculus. And to answer them, we're going to apply six big ideas. I call these the six pillars of calculus. The first big idea I call close is good enough. In algebra, you look for exact answers. In calculus, you make approximations. You do an approximation, you get an approximate answer, and then you refine it. You make a better approximation and a better approximation until you have enough accuracy for whatever problem you're trying to solve. If you want an infinitely accurate answer, you take the limit of better and better and better approximations. The second big idea I call track the changes. The way to understand any quantity in the real world is to look at how fast it's changing, and that's called the derivative. We'll have a lot to say about that later in the class. What goes up has to stop before it comes down. At the top of it, if you throw a ball at the top of its arc, it's not rising and it's not falling. To maximize anything or to minimize anything or to do the best at anything, you look for the spots where something has stopped moving. And because you know how to track the changes, you can figure out when the rate of change has become zero. The whole is the sum of the parts. If you've got any big quantity that you want to study, like what's the total number of people who get pneumonia in the course of a year, you break into pieces. How many get pneumonia on January 1st? How many get pneumonia on January 2nd? All the way to December 31st. And for each piece, you estimate what's happening in that piece, you figure out the contribution of that piece, and you put them back together. This process of putting little pieces together to make big things is called integration. The whole changes the sum of the partial changes. we relate integration, putting things together, and derivatives, rates of change. The fundamental theorem of calculus shows how those two things are related. And finally, when we get to multivariable problems, we study them one variable at a time. This is basic experimental design. You don't vary the temperature and the pressure and the salinity and the concentration of such and such chemical all at the same time. You vary one thing and see what happens when you just change the temperature, or just change the salinity, or just change the pressure. So the same thing goes for math. Most of the concepts that we develop in one variable calculus will carry over very neatly to multivariable calculus if you just remember to do things one variable at a time. So, okay, that's our preview of coming attractions. In the next video, we'll actually get started on calculus.